Are your finances kind of a mess? Did you start a new online business like Patreon or OnlyFans and you're not sure how to deal with the income? Need someone to decode and translate your tax return? Or are you confused about how to handle the influx of money from a Kickstarter, GoFundMe, or even renting out a spare room on Airbnb? What you need is M3 Virtual Accounting. Molly Morris is the accountant for Unspoiled and other successful podcasts, and she can advise you on how to launch a new business, manage the books on an existing one, and meet with you virtually to discuss specific concerns and questions. All of your information is kept in a secure portal where you can upload new documents, sign remotely, and download copies for yourself. Molly has been great to work with, and I wish I had hired her sooner. Her rates are flexible, and she's willing to work within your budget. Her goal is to make professional accounting accessible to small businesses and startups, and she would love to talk to you about what you need. Check out her website at m3virtualaccounting.com and book a free consultation by choosing Book Online in the menu. If you're like me, you will wonder how you ever lived without her.
This is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 14, Cold Days, Chapters 16, 17, and 18. In these chapters, Harry's head has something in it.
Mm.
The island has something in it. And just generally, there's like a lot of bad news in these chapters. Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder, pouring rain. I'm coming down like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. You're only young, but you're gonna die. I won't take no prisoners, won't spare no lives. Nobody's putting up a fight. Welcome to the show, everyone. I am Natasha.
I'm Rashawn.
So, Rashawn, tell me what your first feelings are on learning some of what we find out this episode.
I want to just start by saying I am not feeling great, so I might sound like I'm not excited about what we got in these two chapters. Please don't feel that way. I am very excited. And also terrified. I just don't feel very good.
Rashawn is really trooping through this. So,
but yes. You. So, what did I think? So, you had asked me last time, you know, what did I think the well, you know, what might be going on there? And I, if I remember right, my guess was like really lacking in imagination.
I honestly don't remember what you posited. Do you remember?
Not exactly, but I feel like if it would be something along the lines of me thinking that there was like some sort of ancient source of power, and that's what all the ley lines were about.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess if I wanted to be really generous, I could say, okay, I was close. But I really wasn't. Because nowhere in my mind did I ever for a second think that this was some kind of like supernatural Rikers Island. You know, I just didn't think that. Well, yeah. Whatever I was thinking, it wasn't that. And the reveal of one, what's really going on underneath Demonreach and what Harry's relationship to that is now. On top of the little tidbit that just sort of slipped in there in a way that I thought deserved way more fanfare, was this parasite that's in Harry's mind that he can't know about.
Yeah, I didn't really care for how it was just, oh yeah, I'm like going to tell you about it, like, so that you can have total anxiety over it, but I'm definitely like not going to inform you about any way.
And then after that, Harry is also like, well, you know what? I can't worry about that now.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, sir, you could worry about that a little bit. I don't think that's unreasonable. So it really did just kind of get dropped in there real quick, and then we just brushed right by it. And I want to know what the fuck is going on with that. And I think Demonreach says something like Molly can kind of explain it.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's no time to follow up with Molly because she falls asleep and then the boat gets attacked.
He doesn't even, like, say she can explain it. Harry just asks, how do I get it out?
Oh,
and
right.
He says, ask Grasshopper.
Right, right, right. So.
Your chair is so squeaky.
It's so loud.
Oh, my God.
I don't know why it's gotten so much worse. It's really on its last legs. It's a chair and it's on its last legs.
Oh, my God.
I'm sorry. I apologize.
I can't believe you literally said out loud, ha, 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 before you, like, told the joke again. Oh, I don't know why that's so funny.
I always crack myself up the most. It's really a terrible part of my personality.
That's your best part of your personality. I don't know what you're talking about.
But oh my God, now I can hear this chair.
I'm sorry. Get some WD-40, problem solved. You're good.
There's so much else going on in these two chapters. I don't want to get, like, overly sidetracked with the parasite thing. I will say that my brain, whenever things are dark and inexplicable, my brain always goes back to the Denarians.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just like, oh, what if, like, I don't know how that would work, what it would look like. But what if somehow that was a thing that was happening again? And that's
you
all
mean
I'm
like
about that.
Like he didn't actually get Lashiel out?
Yeah, like what if that didn't really go down the way, you know, I thought it went down? I don't know, girl. I don't know.
I'm sorry. My Jesus was at your chair there because it's like it's getting to a point where it's almost drowning you out a couple of times.
I'm gonna try not to fidget as much as I am prone to do.
When you're not feeling good, though, I understand that impulse.
I keep, like, squirming to, like, put my hands around my belly, and then the chair tells on me, and I have to stop doing it.
No.
but, yeah, whenever we start thinking about weird things that live in Harry's brain, mm-hmm. I always go back to that. And it just, I think it's just because it reminds me of it, and I can't picture anything else. And my brain is like, all right, why don't we just latch onto that thing again? But I feel like one of these times, I'm going to be right.
Well, I guess we'll find out.
Like, maybe in, like, 10 books from now. this whole thing about the island, though, it was really, really good. And it was really well written, I thought.
Yeah, agreed. So the first of these, the 16, starts with Harry descending into the depths of hell.
Everything
about
this is great.
So many steps that he's just, I think he says that he stops counting around the, like, 1200 mark or something.
It's like the 200s. And it's like he stops counting and decides to just find out how many steps there are. And it's almost like for a second he forgot, like, why am I counting like a jackass?
I forgot about that. Yep.
And it turns out that there are 1,728 stairs, and it's 12 cubed. That seems really specifically mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it means anything. I'm not like a numerology person. I don't know if there's some significance to, you know, that number.
Yeah, I don't either.
But it's
one
a lot
seven
of fucking
is eight.
Stairs.
8 and 2 is 10, which is 1 plus 8 is 9. I don't know if that's anything. Hmm. Well.
What just happened?
Oh, numerology, where you like condense the numbers down?
Oh, so no.
1728. You take 1 and 7 for 17 and add those together, 8. 8 and 2 from the 28. 2 and 8 is 10, which is, you take the 0 off, so that's 1. And then 1 and 8 from the end of 28, and that's 9. And, huh, like, 9 is a number of power a lot of times, but...
I didn't know that about condensing the numbers down. I never knew that.
Yeah, that's like... habits die hard. Look, I'm just saying. I don't necessarily buy the shit anymore, but I sure fucking know how. I was going through some shit with my fiance earlier this week, and I informed my mother of where I was and what was happening, and she just immediately wrote me back paragraph upon paragraph on about his birth chart and the planets were right now and what they meant for him and how long this was going to last, and just... It's enough to make you not want to tell her anything. I tell you
what. Oh, Jesus.
Just too much information.
That's pretty intense, though.
Yeah.
Like, if you are asking for someone to do that for you, then you're at least mentally prepared, you know, in the right space.
Mm-hmm.
But just to have it show up in your phone, like, I didn't ask for the
whole thing. Yeah, a little bit.
Just send me a fucking huggy emoji. Goddamn.
So they head down and, eventually, and Harry just does his like down to Goblin Town. He's singing and Demonreach is understandably like, are you, what?
Demonreach is all of us through the course of these books so far. Just like always, really, we have to do this.
You're so never tiring.
Right? You can never take a break from this.
So they get to the bottom and Harry can feel this like crazy energy going on. And Demonreach tells him, look and like remember. And Harry realizes that he's entering a code basically onto the wall and telling Harry to pay attention because like, obviously, if Harry were to enter this wrong in a place of this kind of power, it'd be bad. It'd be bad news.
Yeah.
So Harry pays very close attention, indeed. And they go inside. And it's where he was being kept alive.
Yeah. But I wanted to say before they go through the door and he uses the security code, Harry asked him... a couple of questions. He asks him, why does Demonreach call him Warden?
Right.
And he explains, and he doesn't explain, because he doesn't explain shit.
Yeah,
He just says back, because Harry's like, you know, there's plenty of Wardens. I'm not like the Warden. I'm not even a very good one. And Demonreach says, there are many, but first there was one. And he points to a sigil on the wall and asks Harry if he recognizes it. And it takes him a minute, and then he realizes that it's Merlin.
Yeah.
It's like the Merlin.
Mm-hmm.
And we get like a little, you know, background on like the myth of what Merlin did after Excalibur and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Which was a lot, according to Harry.
Mm-hmm.
And then they go into doing the security code thing.
So Harry recognizes this and sort of has this moment of just really remembering very intensely everything he went through and the pain of it. And when he comes back to himself, Demonreach says, memory, reflection. And Harry's like, are you saying I just went into an internal monologue because I came in here? Demonreach did not seem to feel a need to clarify. Memory. Reflection. But that does seem to be the implication.
Mm-hmm.
And...
yeah, it was, like, pretty spot-on self-analysis, even for Harry, who's, mm-hmm, you know, generally pretty self-aware.
I kind of like it because that's supposed to be what prison is for, allegedly. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's to, like, give you a place to think about the shit you did and want to be better.
Right.
And I just
or to
punish
you with, like, living with what you did.
Right.
Depending on, you know, where which angle you come at from it.
So, yeah, I just, I thought that that was a neat thing to, like, pull that in here because that just often is sort of discarded as the point of prison.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
We've moved so far. I was going to say we moved so far away from that, but I don't think we were ever close to that in this country.
No, not really.
So that was a nonsense thing I almost said. Harry asked one of what I think are the most important questions. He wants to know, what is the deal? What is the purpose of this place that we are at?
Right.
And the answer is just containment. Mm-hmm. Which I know Demonreach speaks this way anyway, but I feel like saying containment is especially menacing. It's like worse than even saying like prison, I think.
Mm.
Something about
why is that?
Because containment
this fucking feels, dog.
Well, at least my chair quieted down. because I think containment for me implies that if the walls are gone, whatever is in there is not only going to be out, but is going to be especially harmful.
Hmm.
Where prison is just like, is about keeping, you know, the people that are in there because of something they did that makes them deserve to be in there. You know, they are not necessarily going to be harmful if they're out of prison.
Gotcha. Yeah.
The containment to me feels like if it gets out, it's a wrap.
Yeah, that's basic. Because Harry says, so here they're not dangerous. And he says, they are always dangerous, but here they have less opportunity to express it.
Yeah, I love that too.
Yeah.
It's a really.
And even Harry stops and is like, ooh, that's like the most he's ever talked, and I don't like this. Like,
yeah.
This feels too important.
Yeah. When Harry asks what's being contained, the answer is the least. Which, again, a really simple word choice, right? It's because that's the whole thing with Demonreach, right? He's got to, like, get right to the point because he is a thing of few words.
True.
And but each word he chooses is so packed.
So he, Harry, like, sees this moment. First he says, so does this job, like, come with benefits, or, and realizes nobody is entertaining his fuckery right now.
Yeah.
And Harry's like, could they get loose? And he says, with outside intervention or your authorization. And Harry's like, wait, I could set it loose? And he says, you are the warden. And Harry all at once thinks about how bad this looks for him.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, just overall, the whole White Council, they do not trust him. And if they found out he was in this position, and if other beings found out that he was in this position, it would be a bad time.
Yeah, yeah. This is probably one of the worst things that could come up for Harry, considering the thing he's already in the middle of dealing with, which, you know, was not a small thing.
Yes.
He's been, you know, tasked with killing Maeve. And if he doesn't do that, the consequences will be dire.
Yeah.
And then, you know, he just stumbles into this kind of.
Let's see. Here it is. The very best part, I didn't actually have a really usable super weapon. I just had the key to a great big box full of pain and trouble for a whole lot of people. And realizes that probably Ebenezer knew what this place was. Mm-hmm. So when Harry told him what he'd done, that's why Ebenezer had the fucking reaction he did.
Yeah. Which, you know, hindsight.
Mm-hmm.
When Harry is getting an idea of, like, what this place really is, and Bob, because Bob is, you know, with him in his little bag. There's a funny moment where they're still walking down the stairs, and at one point, Bob is like, you know, could you please stop trying to piss this thing off? But Bob is the one who tells Harry to look at the floor and through the crystals, and he recognizes the what we were calling the menace from the one of the other
a shag nasty shag nasty but yes
never mind
what
I was gonna say from the north side shag nasty
oh my god ma'am
the Connecticut Shag Nasties.
Oh, Shag Nasty of the Connecticut Shag Nasties. Oh, you might know my father. Please. My father is Mr. Shag Nasty. I'm Shag Nasty the first. Yeah, you really must be in pain if you're laughing at these. These are bad jokes for Sean.
I took a little something for the pain. So maybe,
Fair.
All right. So that's where we are with the island. Mm-hmm. He has been given control of this. Do we know why?
Come closer to the mic.
We think the reason Harry's in this position, because he thinks about Ebenezer having that reaction. Harry's in the warden because of the sort of mind meld deal he did.
Yeah, it seems like that's the implication there.
Okay. All right. So, I mean, what a time for this to come back up, though.
This dude is the genius loci, and Harry did I can't remember the name of the thing. Whatever it was that he did seems to be the thing that...
Yeah. When does Bob explain what is going on? Is that the next chapter?
The next one, the end of it.
All right. So, yeah, we find out that Demonreach is everything. He is. Mm-hmm. He says, I'm the guard, the walls, the bars. I am order. He is just... And we find out later exactly what that means about, like, he is... can't extend his reach beyond the island. He is so tied in with the space and the spell that's happening there that it's like he's holding everything together single-handedly.
Yes.
But that was what he was created to do, I'm guessing, so it's not like he feels bad about doing that.
Brendan Hone sent me notes. Thank you, Brendan. Ebenezer was stunned / horrified when Harry told him that he had performed a sanctum invocation on the island. Thanks, Brendan. I was coming in on the clinch before the big showdown in Book 11, Turncoat. Harry was just trying to get a home field advantage over Shag Nasty and whoever framed Morgan, but it turns out Harry bit off more than he could chew as usual.
Yeah, how about that?
That is true.
Yeah. It's so wild how this shit comes back. You know, everything comes back a couple books down the road. Because I haven't been thinking about what happened on that island.
Yeah.
There's been a bunch of other shit happening. I didn't forget it happened, but it wasn't anything that was on my mind anymore.
Same thing with the headaches.
Mm-hmm.
Brendan points out the first mention we get is at the beginning of Book 11. The book starts with him complaining about a headache, and then Morgan knocks on his door and makes his day a whole lot worse. In the next scene, Butters asks Harry about the headaches, indicating they've been an ongoing problem, and Harry lies, claiming they're getting better, but Butters sees through his bullshit.
Right, that's right.
Yeah.
Ugh. A lot of moving pieces.
There's just many things that Butcher will bring up, just simmer on the back burner until we forget it's there, and then all of a sudden he'll throw the boiling water in your face and be like, ah, you forgot about this, you stupid idiot. So, thanks, Butcher.
At the one point they're talking, and he mentions about this headache coming on, and Demonreach growls, and his headache goes away. Mm-hmm. And Harry is so shocked by how quickly it disappears. He says, like, his endorphins got to his, you know, got there and there was nothing to do. So he just felt really good for a second. And he asks, you know, what happened? What did you do? And Demonreach says, I warned it.
Yeah, I like it, that.
I did not care for it.
I suffer from migraines, and I would really like a Demonreach. Yeah. Thanks.
And that's when we find out that there's the parasite, the creature causing it, the parasite, which I can't tell you how much I dislike the idea of things living inside you. I've talked to you guys about that in the past. You know how I feel about that.
Yeah.
It skeeves. Terrible.
Skeeves.
And this is when Harry is like, you know, you won't tell me about it. And he says the thing bargained with Harry's life. And that's why he can't tell Harry what it is. But if you don't figure it out, the shit is going to burst forth from your skull, which I thought was delivered very casually.
Yep. Yep. And Harry's just goes, ah!
Look, the absolute right thing to do and say.
It's true, though. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's that news. Yeah.
Oh, and it's going to happen soon. BT dubs.
Priorities. Put the skull bursting parasite issue aside for the moment. That leaves me in charge of veritable doomsday machine. They aren't going to flip about it today because they don't know I'm alive. If I don't stay focused on the next 24 hours, I might not live long enough to have all that fun. So we forget about that for now, too. Sensible priorities.
I'm gonna start saying that.
I'm going to start saying when anybody asks me a question, you are too limited. It would damage you.
You kind of low-key already do that, though.
I carry that energy. Oh, that's true, though. He's trying to, like, tell Harry what the fuck, and Harry can't handle it.
Yeah.
And finally, he's like, can you draw me a picture? And he's like, joking? But Demonreach is like, well.
Right.
Maybe. And he just goes and grabs Bob.
He could have just asked Harry to handle him.
Fucking Bob is like, hey, hey. Like, didn't agree to this.
I mean, can you imagine, like,
where's my consent form?
The vines are going, like, all out of his eye sockets and all.
Oh, my God.
That must be horrifying for him. So, yeah, Bob is concerned about where this is going.
Yes.
And Harry gets, like, really, you better fucking put him down or, you know, we're not going to have any kind of understanding at all.
Mm-hmm.
And Bob realizes almost immediately what's happening here. And Harry just sort of watches Bob get brought up to speed about what this is all about.
Yeah.
And it's kind of fun to watch because Harry doesn't know what the hell's going on. So we just get Harry watching Bob's little reactions.
I love Harry being like, he's watching and Bob says at one point, like, oh.
Yeah.
And Harry says, what? And he says, no, it just had to dumb it down a little before I got it. And then Harry says, okay, so what is it? Hold on. I'm now dumbing it down enough for you to get it.
So good. Oh, yeah, it's so good.
Listen, Harry, don't be offended. He's a spirit of intellect. He's going to be a little bit better at comprehension than you. It's nothing personal.
Oh. Bob is being, like, really sassy now. All of a sudden, like, he's been terrified, like, you know, all the way through this whole ordeal. And Harry's like, well, look at you being all kind of wise-ass about it. And Bob is like, well, it needs me now. I'm important, so I feel a lot safer.
I love that. That makes me important, and it knows it. You.
So what they are trying to explain to Harry is is how the island was made, what Merlin did.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason it's so hard to understand, first of all, really, really quickly, Bob has got this, like, whole Oscar-type movie he's put together.
I thought about this, too, the first time. I really, this would be just how I would fucking, how I would do this, because I, this is how my dreams are. So, I would absolutely just, I would do too much.
It is very involved. There's some kind of sex scene with Jenna Jameson and Carrie Fisher.
He's got the, like, Fox, like, logo. Like,
there's a... There's like when Merlin shows up, it says like on the screen, Merlin. and I guess he picked Alec Guinness to be him in his movie. Oh, mm-hmm. My goodness. But, and then they have to fast forward it.
shit's taking too long. Get to the point.
That just really, really tickled me because, you know, it was only like a minute that he was, you know, having a conversation with Demonreach anyway, but he's got this whole fucking, odyssey that he's prepared. But the important bits are that the thing they have to understand is that when Merlin built the island, he did it in 5 different times simultaneously.
Right.
And that was the hardest part of what Demonreach was trying to explain. It just, you know, I guess our you know, measly little human brains just couldn't wrap itself around that.
Yeah. And 5 different times all in the same place,
mm-hmm.
at the same time is how he puts it.
Yeah.
And eventually, within this movie, Harry gets, like, shown an example, like a creative interpretation. What is it that they say when they, like, show you what looks to be a picture of Jupiter, but they're just, like, artist rendering?
Yeah.
Right? An artist rendering of what these spells actually look like in action, and Harry has to look away because they begin to hurt his brain.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a little bit too much. And... even Bob is like, yeah, sorry about that. Like, this reminder, Bob needed a minute to get it. It wasn't even like they told him, oh, here's what he did. And Bob was like, oh, okay. They tried to explain it. And he was like, what?
Right.
And then they had to, like, you know, and that was sort of, that jives with what we saw in the ruins outside. When he's trying to make sense of one stone,
mm-hmm.
and the first layer of what is on that one stone. And he's like, I'm not even done.
Right, right.
It's been 20 minutes and I'm still doing it. So,
and they mentioned, yeah. He mentioned when he was going down in the first chapter that the lower they got, he began to realize that everything was made of the same exact stone that was left over in the ruins of the cottage and by the tower.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, definitely like the same magic, but not. Have we learned what happened to that area, the cottage, and why?
I don't think so. I think that, like, the main thing that we have been told is just how people were driven away from this place because it wasn't safe to live, and
right.
The energy eventually, like, caused them all to,
yeah.
abandoned ship, but I don't know if anything specific happened or if that's like a result of destruction or just neglect,
right.
or what.
Yeah. I'm only curious because it's the same type of stone. I figured, you know, it would have been built by whoever built the stairs, I guess Merlin.
Yeah,
but,
probably.
So this is some pretty heavy stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And once Harry kind of digest that part, we find out that something is going to happen. Some person at some place it in some time.
Indeed.
It's going to throw so much energy towards the island that it's just going to cause basically like a nuclear bomb. Mm-hmm. It's just going to, what does he say? Like, take out the Midwest, I think he says.
Yeah, later on, I think what he says is make the continental shelf have a really bad day.
Jesus.
Is the way he words that.
Yeah, yeah, that's a lot.
Yeah.
And, I think it happens the next day, tomorrow.
Yeah, it's tomorrow. And when he's like, oh, okay, so I have to stop them tomorrow, Bob's like, no. You have to stop them whenever they do it,
mm-hmm.
which might have been a week ago. So in that case, oops. Sorry, bad luck. It's too late. Just overall, most of the info that Harry's getting here isn't super
It's great. All bad news.
Yeah.
It is. I don't think he's had any good news. I mean, the reunion with Thomas and Molly, you know, are good. But I'm trying to think, like, last time he got good news. It's maybe, I guess, not being dead all the way was good news.
I guess.
But look at what he's gotten himself into.
Yeah,
so I feel like, you know, that could really go either way.
I love when he does the summary and then is like, ah, this is what it feels like to get back to my life. Like, this feels right. How bent is that? Yeah.
Oh, Jesus.
I think we all have those realizations at some point in our lives where all of a sudden we step back and we're like, oh, this feels normal to me. Oh, this mm-hmm. is not a good, oh no.
I'm not going to admit how much I know that feeling. So, we're just going to move along.
Fair enough. So, let's see. I'm trying to find the moment where... Oh, my God. Oceans of Power rose up. He did it again twice. And then Bob is like, like five times, actually. The basic star and circle architecture is the same as the work you do, Harry. And he says, and here's the problem. So Harry sees there's this, like, red glow. And let's see. The dissonance appeared. It began as something faint, but then, like, an oncoming headache started to throb into something larger and more noticeable. Where scarlet and blue light touched, there were ugly flares of energy. Flares that I had been sensing ever since I'd gotten to the island. Before long, that scarlet pulse had spread to half the island, and then abruptly the screen went white. Hmm. Text at the bottom read, November 1st. And Bob says, a directed burst of energy hits it, unravels the whole containment spell, and triggers the failsafe. Fire! Rumbled Demonreach. I figured that one out, thanks, I said. So basically, Bob says that what they've been sensing is like the ripples of the effect of it going backward in time.
This, my brain got a little like woozy.
Yeah,
feel you. This part. And I get so easily fucked up when you start talking about time and paradox and shit like that. My brain is just like, oh, do we have to?
I just always have a hard time processing this shit. It's part of why I don't love a lot of time travel storylines, because I feel like you could low-key do whatever, and I probably wouldn't catch that you completely, like, just fudged shit, because it makes so little sense to me anyway. So, yeah. It's just, I always, depending on what you're like reading or watching, time travel rules are like slightly different, which be fun, but also I get confused because it's hard for me to follow anyway. So then I'll be like, but wait, what about this? And then it turns out, well, in this universe, that doesn't matter, you know?
I do know.
Well, that's so aggressive.
I do.
You said it like, bitch, like at the end of the sentence, like unsaid, but definitely there.
I just really, you know, I just felt what you were saying. That's all. supposed to mean? So this explanation, I'm sure it is very, you know, good and well written and makes sense to a lot of people. I was just like, okay.
Your understanding is limited. The explanation would damage you, Rashawn.
Clearly.
Harry's like, well, what about this dude here? Can't he do something? And Bob's like, he doesn't get to just wander around and, like, handle shit. And Harry says, he was at the graveyard when I was dead. Mm. And Bob says it bullied Meb into helping it. And he says, I did not care for that. I bargained. And I want to know what the fuck he bargained. Like, was it just in exchange for helping keep Harry alive? Or was there something else?
Well, this is the second bargain that he's mentioned. He's just out here cutting deals with all kinds of people for who God knows what. Apparently all in an effort to keep Harry alive, which is clearly the most important thing. So this thing is out there making deals with whatever parasites in his head, made a deal with Mab. He's putting in a lot of work on Harry's behalf.
That's true.
Huh. Hmm. I mean,
better be fucking worth it, Harry.
Right? I am feeling that a little bit. I feel like that is coloring some of its interaction with Harry.
So... let's see. He takes Bob back, says he's on it. Demonreach just says, good. And then he goes running up the 1700 some odd stairs. That
doesn't even stop. Doesn't even get that little weird pain you get in your side, you know, when you think you're going to die because you ran too much.
I had that like last week when I was trying to jog. I say trying, and I mean trying.
I think I ran for a bus back in 2017 that I thought I didn't care for it. That might be the last time I ran anywhere.
You just said back in 2017. You named the year.
I don't run.
Man. So the beginning of the next chapter, first of all, he heals himself a little bit for being able to run.
Yeah.
Then he gets back on the boat, and I had forgotten, honestly, by this point, that Thomas and Molly are right there waiting for him.
It's kind of same.
Yeah. I was like imagining for some reason that they were like at the parking lot at the marina. I forgot they were right there. And so Harry tells them basically the world's going to end unless I do something about it in the next, like, 20 hours. And Thomas is like, yep.
That sounds about right. How you left it.
So they get moving. And all of a sudden, there is... first, dawn breaks. And Harry talks a bit about how clear that feeling is when that happens. And...
also mentions that whatever spells that were keeping all the ways blocked from the Never Never, that spell is going to be gone at sunrise.
Yeah.
So maybe they should hurry up.
And as they're like racing back to the other, back to shore, he is looking at Molly and just really sort of meditating on the fact that she looks so different. She has really aged, and not in like a, oh, she looks so old now, but she doesn't look like a kid like she did for such a while.
Yeah.
And there is a like sort of heaviness to her energy. She used to be very buoyant and joyful and excited, and that's not there. And he hadn't realized how much that was sort of the key to who she was to him until it was gone. And now he's just like, man, I really miss that.
Yeah. And it doesn't come right out. And so, like, he talks about, like, you know, what she's been through and how, like, training with Leah and living on the streets and fighting on the streets and how all that takes a toll. But, you know, he's also thinking about having taken her with him to Chichen Itza.
Chichen Itza, yeah.
It'll do.
Yeah, you got pretty close, actually. It was almost right. I don't even know that the way he says it is right, to be fair, so.
That's right. Hold me to standards. We haven't even verified yet.
Listen, colonizer for you. but
you know he's thinking it. You know, that part is, I imagine, always with him. And the feeling of guilt about that. And then she tells him to settle down.
Yeah, and he's like, "What are you listening to my head?" And she says, "Only when I want to hear the roar of the ocean." Which I really like the idea of being psychic and tuning in on somebody, and it's just like waves crashing and maybe like seagull sounds. That'd be pretty good, actually.
There's a old Simpsons thing where inside Homer's head is just one of those wind-up monkeys with cymbals.
Do you remember that in I'm rewatching True Blood with my friend Sydney, and there's a point where she's trying to read Tara's mind because she can tell Tara's lying to her, and she tunes in, and Tara's just going, "La la 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 la." And I fucking died. I laughed so hard. Because she's like staring at her with her eyes really wide. So you know something's happening. But once she tunes in and you hear that so loud, it's just like, it really goes together.
So, she really was one of the best parts of that show. What a shame.
Criminal. Criminal. So... half the sun was over Chicago, over the horizon when Chicago's skyline came into sight. I just basked in that for a minute. Yeah, I know, stupid, but it's my town, and I'd been gone for what felt like a lifetime. It was good to see the autumn sun gleaming off of glass and steel. Then I felt myself tense, and I pushed myself up from where I'd been leaning on the guardrail. I took a moment to look around me very carefully. I don't know what had set off my instincts, but they were doing the same routine they'd learned to do every time Mab had been about to spring her daily assassination attempt, and I couldn't have ignored them if I'd wanted to. Yeah. I really love that. Basically, him being like, "Oh yeah, that worked.
Yeah, yeah.
That sucked. It sucked, but it worked. I gotta give her that." And then they spot the fucking red cap.
Yeah, on jet skis, which makes them somehow 500% more douchey than they already were. Right.
Agreed. This is like a fucking Bond villain right now. Like, stop it. Stop it.
Like, you could have knocked me over when I read that. Because it doesn't really fit with any part of any of the story that we've gotten so far, you know? Yep. It's like you said, it's like a Bond villain. It's like we're watching Miami Vice all of a sudden. Like, what are you talking about on jet skis? It's so weird.
Oh, God. So, I forgot about this part, too. Harry asks if, let's see. Here it is. Thomas opened the throttle and passed me, I kid you not, a shiny brass telescope. Seriously? I asked him. Ever since those pirate movies came out, they're everywhere, he said. I've got a sextant, too. Any tent you have is a sextant, I muttered darkly. Oh, that's such a dumb joke, but I like it. So, the main thing is that as douchey as these speed... what are they? Water speeds? Water boats?
Jet skis.
That's the one.
Water boats.
Jet skis. Thank you. Oh, my God. Earlier, I was talking to Jamie, and she was trying to remember the position of who, the name of it, of the person who, like, interacts with the media on behalf of the president. And I was like, Speaker of the House! Speaker! Speak! This House! Speak! Press secretary! And she was like, what just happened? I, like, was nowhere near it, and then I just got it. So, despite the fact that this makes them extra douchey, it also makes them extra fucking dense because they didn't think about the fact that these are electric and Harry has some ways of interfering with that shit. Yeah.
It's at first it looks a little dicey because they are not only are they pursuing them on jet skis, but they're also heavily armed and they're shooting the fuck out of Thomas's little boat. Yep. And even though they're going 60 miles an hour on these things, they are still really good marksmen. And Harry reminds us that all that grace that we saw on the dance floor also translates into being able to like kill people efficiently.
The way you said that just had it. I just heard, you know, like when they had that dance off. You know, the skills we previously saw on the dance floor. It's like a step up movie.
God, that would actually, I would be here for that if that happened at Winter Court. Like just like the dance competition. That'd be pretty compelling,
actually.
Yeah, I would be in for that. So yeah, but then
step up five Winter Court. I like it.
So they are. It's not looking great for our friends. And then Harry decides maybe magic is the way to go, which I thought he would lead with, but you know.
Well, first he asks Molly for help.
With the mist?
Yeah, and she's like, that's a lot of mist. I can't do that. And he's like, it doesn't have to be real. And she's like, oh, right. Yes, I can do that. Okay, cool. Which I kind of liked because I didn't get that's what he meant either. So once he cleared that up, I'm like, okay, cool. And that's how he lures them in.
I immediately went to illusion for Molly. And then, so when she replies back with about how that's a lot, what did she say? It's a lot of fire and I don't work well with that.
Yeah.
I was like, what is she talking about?
Because she suggests at first to veil the boat.
Mm-hmm.
And he points out that the wake will give them away. And she's like, oh, shit. And it seems like once he says that, she gives up on the idea entirely. Like, well, I guess if I can't veil it, then no illusion magic.
Right.
But that's not entirely true. This is what she does. And he describes the movements that she makes while she's doing this as, like, braiding, which I found kind of interesting. You know? Where is it? Here it is. My apprentice closed her eyes and clenched her fists. I saw her focus, felt the slight stirring in the air as she gathered her will and power. Then she moved her hands in a complicated little gesture, whispering something. She continued making the gesture, and I realized the motion was duplicating that of weaving three lines into a braid. From between her fingers, a thick white mist began to appear. First it came as a trickle, but as I watched, it thickened into a stream. Then Molly bowed her head in concentration and muttered words beneath her breath, and a sudden plume of white mist bigger than the water beetle itself began jetting from her hands and spreading out to blanket the surface of the water over the boat's wake, shutting the pursuing she away from view. So yeah, that's pretty cool. Awesome. Yeah. I like that.
I don't think we've seen that yet with Molly before, so this is new.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah, that's pretty cool. It's fun watching her develop over the course of these books. You know, yeah. That's been pretty cool. I mean, Harry too. You know, he's developed a lot more magic and power along the way. But I feel like you kind of expect that because you know he's the main guy. But the books are named after him. But it's been really cool watching a character that I didn't expect to really ever even care that much about.
Mm-hmm.
Becoming such like an important part of the story and watching her grow each time too. That's been a really unexpected little treat.
Agreed. I think that's one of my favorite things about these books, and it's something that you can really do when you have a long series like this, is you can allow all of your side characters a lot of growth as well in a way that shorter series just don't necessarily allow you to explore without it feeling like, but I want to go back to the main story. What's this?
Yeah, you know? Yeah. Oh, God, that is so true. You get, like, you know, a big ticket show everybody's into. God forbid you spend 2 minutes on, like, a different plot. Mm-hmm. Everybody's complaining how the show has completely lost its way.
I don't know what you mean. I've never said anything like that. What? Moi? So, let's see. This is when the Red Cap was guiding the jet ski with one hand and held a military carbine in the other. His eyes widened as the vehicle rushed closer, but rather than swerving to one side, he broke out into a wild smile, swung the gun around to point at me, and accelerated. Before he could shoot, I unleashed my gathered will into a burst of completely unfocused magical energy, shouting, "Hexus!" And he says it suffered an abrupt engine failure. There was a sound of tearing metal, a flash of flame, the handlebar twisted, the nose plunged into the water, and flung the Red Cap off it at full speed. He'd been doing maybe 60 when I hit him, and he skipped twice across the water's surface before he slammed into a swell from the water beetle's wake and vanished under the surface.
This is all fantastic.
I love the fact that he skips.
Yeah, like bounces off the water twice before he goes in.
That is hysterical.
Yeah, this is all really good, especially because, one, we've met this particular guy and we already can't stand him. Mm-hmm. And then the way he turns and accelerates towards the boat is just, and the smile, you just want to punch him right in the fucking face. So this was delightful.
And then Thomas turns and runs one of them over with the boat. And then Molly uses a hexus on this other dude. And the jet ski Thomas had missed suddenly began billowing smoke. Its roaring engine cut away to a gasping, labored rattle. So he hexes another two. I don't know if we know how many there are total. But one of the jet skis abruptly began coasting to a stop, and the other took a sharp right turn and then simply went on turning in a furious continuous circle, which I find really amusing.
Those are like, he says that because they're not as close to him when he hexes them, we don't get like the full big dramatic impact that we got with the first Red Cap.
Right.
But these, the one just going in circles, it's just... It's just, it's really too good. Because there's something that just is so undignified by it.
Agreed, exactly.
I was going to say real quick so people aren't yelling at me. I said about Harry waiting kind of long to throw magic around with these jet skis, but he says at the beginning that his training with Mab has been so close and in such close quarters that he wasn't effective so far away from them.
Yes.
So.
So Molly is just like laid out, literally snoring. Thomas tells him that we'll be getting to shore in about 15 minutes. And
Thomas got
he has
shot.
Been shot. Yeah, through the arm. He didn't hit bone, at least. Let's see. Oh, Harry cleans it, tapes it up, and then says, "Okay, you can stop complaining now." Thomas, who had been silent the whole time, gave me a look. So Harry's like, "So what are you doing? You want to help me with this?
Want to hang
he
out?"
Snorted. "You mean, would I like to follow you around, wondering what the hell is going on, because you won't tell me everything, then get in a fight with something that is going to leave me in intensive care?" "Uh-huh," I said, nodding. "Pretty much." "Yeah," he said. "Okay." And that is the end of chapter 18.
That's really good. I really enjoyed all three of these. Yay! I like seeing Thomas back with Harry. I'm excited that they're going to go on an adventure together.
Agreed. Yeah.
So it feels to me like despite everything that Harry has been lying to himself about, you know, staying solo to keep everybody safe, we've got Molly back in. We've got Thomas actively back in. Butters knows what's going on. Andy knows that he's back. How long before we see Karen? I feel like Harry's going to want to keep putting that off because it's going to be just too emotionally everything. But will he be allowed to keep putting it off? Or will someone or something force him to have to go and make contact with her? What do you think?
Well, it's hard to say because I really have no idea at all. At all. So I'm going to say yes. Damn. I hope that was helpful. I'm going to say hi to new patrons real quick. Oh my God. I just went to open the new, the thing for reading the patrons' names, but that post was up that I posted in the patrons' off topic group. Did you see what I posted where it's that like graphic about burgers that makes no sense?
No.
Oh my God. All right. I'm not going to get into it. Burgers. Have you ever seen that that Facebook group, Graphic Design is My Passion?
I have seen bits and pieces of it. That's where all the really terrible stuff goes, right?
Yeah. Okay. It's basically like, it's for things that somebody just over-designed a thing and it's basically impossible to read or understand. Sometimes the font's really bad, but sometimes they do that thing where they'll like cut words up and put them together weird. Anyway, this is not interesting because people can't see what it is, but what it's like all these words together, and I'm going to read it just as it looks. When you order grill to we smash sear that fresh ball of beef on a hot buttered the burger, you can taste and delicious burger. And I swear to God, I stared at this shit for 15 minutes, putting the fucking pieces of sentences together and pulling them apart, trying to make it make sense. I cannot make it make sense in any order.
I know exactly what you're talking about. I've seen a couple of those type of just, like, every time I read them, I'm like, am I having a stroke?
Yes. Yes. It was posted in that group, and some the first, like, the top comment under it was like, I smell toast. Does anybody smell toast? Because it genuinely, I'm about to send it to you because I have it saved because I was just so baffled. Usually, I can eventually figure it out and I'm like, okay, this was very badly done, but I see what they were going for. And this one, I have nothing.
I feel like when you see those are made to make your brain go like, what the fuck is happening?
Probably, because I'm sure that like the point of an ad is to make you stop and concentrate on it, right?
Oh, you think it's a real ad?
It is.
Oh.
It's a photo that somebody took of a poster that looks like it's like in a subway station or something like that. Did you get it? I just texted it to you. Anyway, sorry guys. I know that you don't care because you can't see this. But if you're a patron and you're in the off-topic group, it's in there. And you should go and give it a try because I dare you. You are not going to be able to make anything out of it. So, new patrons. This week we have Michael Berry, Shelby Whitehead, Nancy H., Mari Rontescola. I'm going to say Rontescola. Mari Rontescola. And Gwen Aspton. Welcome to all of you. Thank you very, very much for becoming patrons. I hope that y'all are enjoying the content. This Saturday, Rashawn and I are going to be doing our Unsober episode on the game Puff Puff Pass, the Stoners for Card Games, as it is advertised. And I am very excited about it because we've never done a game before, so that should be fun. And earlier today I recorded what may very well be my very final episode of Doctor Who.
Oh, the crowd sighs.
So there, I think we may do one more because there was one like Christmas special episode that people were asking for us to do before we just stopped. And Jamie said that she was going to vet it and go watch it and make sure that it was actually worthwhile because she doesn't trust our fans anymore, which, frankly, I understand. So good for you, Jamie. I appreciate her taking that bullet for me if it's not good. But yeah, just it turns out Doctor Who was just not for me, y'all. And I gave it 8 seasons and really tried. But it is just it just does not hold up to the kind of scrutiny that I, you know, put shows through usually. I say that I'm also covering One Piece, which is lunacy, but One Piece knows what it is. And Doctor Who seems to want to take itself seriously in a way that it just doesn't have any right to do. So that's my problem with it. But if you like One Piece, you should check out those Spoil Me episodes, because somebody commissioned me and they are hilarious. That show is out of pocket. I don't know. It's just great that it exists. So definitely check that out if you're looking for me to enjoy something campy and ridiculous, because that's really the sweet spot, that show, for me. And I think that's everything. Anything else you want to add, ma'am?
No, ma'am.
All right. Well, everybody, we love you very much. I hope that you enjoyed this episode, and we will be seeing you next week with 3 more chapters. Until then, toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
Unspoiled Network Podcast.
But, oh, sorry. That one was just the mic kind of settling in itself. That one wasn't me. It wasn't me, exactly. And honest to God, it wasn't. Sorry. Sorry. It slid out of the... Okay. We're good.